working, first of all. Okay. I think that's okay. Good. Okay, good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome. Bienvenue, as we would say. Can I ask first, do we have any non-Masons or many non-Masons present? A few. Okay. Then let me just explain a couple of quick points, which will come up regularly. One is the view of regularity within Freemasonry. When Freemasonry started back in the 1700s, they developed a number of different versions, and from the point of view of the United Grand Lodge of England, not all of them were all that they would wish it to be. And so, as we will find out as we go along a bit, that some parts of Freemasonry are regarded as regular by the United Grand Lodge of England, and some parts are not. They're regarded as irregular, okay, and are not recognized. And as an English or in a New York Mason, we do not, or not supposed to, associate with a regular Freemasonry. The second part is something we call rites. Within Freemasonry, there are a number of different ways of doing things, many of them quite different, as we will see as we go along a bit. And on the same basis, although they all have the same basic concepts within Freemasonry, they have different ways of going about things and different levels and a number of different ranges. So, and we'll see that as we go along as well. So I just want to make that sort of a little bit of understanding, I hope, in terms of terminology. So, Freemasonry in France. Whoops, where are we? I think that's right. That one? Or is it not on? Sorry, Joseph. It's a central button, surely. Oh, no, it's that one. Sorry, my fault. Slightly different to my own. Okay, the GLNF, Grande Loge National Francaise, was created in 1913 and recognized shortly thereafter by the United Grand Lodge of England and subsequently by other Grand Lodges, particularly in America. So you might think really that from that sort of short period there's not a lot to talk about, but in fact within Freemasonry there's a lot more to talk about than that, and we'll explain why we got there. So within France, obviously, operative Masonry was very evident. If you have ever travelled there, that we have some excellent examples of Masonry through the time, through the Loire Valley and the castles, the cathedrals, and of course particularly Saint-Denis in Paris, which invented the flying buttress so you could build walls up very high without them falling over on you. Quite important concept of the day. However, in terms of free and accepted Masonry, I've not really found any evidence of interaction between operative Masonry in France and what we call speculative or free and accepted Masonry. Masonry appeared in France through basically three different routes, primarily. First of all, people who didn't like the English, which suited the French very well, of course. My enemy's enemy is my friend. The Scots, English Catholics after displacement of James II, and other people, usually known as Jacobites, they fled to France. The French were happy to have them, and some of them brought Freemasonry with them, particularly the Scots. The second, and there was not clear evidence of a Scottish lodge sometime in the 1600s. It's not documented, it's not clear. The second and clearer area were military officers, English and Scottish, serving the French crown as mercenaries. They brought Masonry with them, and in Paris we have clear evidence of lodges formed in 1725, St. Thomas's and St. George's, not my St. George's, but a previous one, at the same time. And then shortly thereafter, a French-speaking lodge, Louis des Argents, formed in 1726. So those lodges are clearly identified. And thirdly, in the south of France, we saw in Bordeaux, which was a major trading port, centre of the wine trade, the development of Masonry there, undertaken by visiting ships, officers and captains. And a couple of years ago, I had the opportunity to visit the Grande Loge in San Francisco, and I heard a similar story to Bordeaux, in as much as lodges were formed and officered by whoever was in port at the time. So the officers were constantly changing within the same lodge, depending on who was there and who was sailing. So the Les Anglais, as it was called, dates from 1732, and Bordeaux being a very cosmopolitan city, it recruited Flemish, Dutch and German members, as well as English-speaking and French members. And in fact, the French membership grew to such an extent, they actually changed to being a French-speaking lodge in 1743. Now, there is an English historian known as Carr, who has written extensively on the subject, and he said basically that English planted Freemasonry and it became an elegant pastime for nobility and gentry. The dukes or so-and-so held a lodge in his house. They would invite a few friends, make a few masons, have a good dinner, and go their merry way. And it was about 10 or 12 years before Masonry started to work its way from the nobility down into the more industrial classes, particularly the merchant classes. And they started forming lodges and meeting in restaurants, generally in bars, particularly. And about this time, 1736, things started to become a little difficult in France, as they had become in England to an extent. The fear goes back right to the beginning of Masonry. It's a secret society. What are they doing? And so the French government particularly was very concerned about the possibility of plotting and conspiracy, even though there was no real risk. So the chief of police of Paris, Rene Hérault, Lieutenant General of Police, brought out a rule that restaurant keepers and tavern keepers were not allowed to give space to Masons, Masonic meetings. And if they did, they would be shut down and fined. And there were a couple of records of this happening. But particularly among the older lodges, which were the nobility lodges, they continued to meet in private houses anyway. So it really didn't stop anything at the time, and he was a bit frustrated. So he decided that if he couldn't close them down that way, he would make them look foolish and silly another way. And so he asked a lady friend of his to a Madame Carton, who's described as a dancer, which was a euphemism at that time in Paris for ladies of an older profession. And this lady is reputed, according to Carr, to have slept in the best beds of Europe. And in fact, Carr suggests he was actually somewhat known to senior members of the British Masonic Order as well, although he doesn't offer much proof of that. Nevertheless, he asked her to find a copy of Masonic Ritual, and she got the copy. We don't quite know how, but we can guess. And this was published as the Reception d'un Freemason. So, and within a month it had been translated and shown in the English newspapers. The net result of this actually was nothing. No one appeared to care. So a bit of a wasted effort from that point of view. So that was that. Now, one of the problems with the early lodges, there was no Grand Lodge in France. There was no central organization. And for example, the Les Anglais we mentioned earlier sort of became a Grand Lodge of its own and licensed, because this goes back to this recognition issue. To create a lodge, you need permission or a license, a warrant, from a superior body. And so Les Anglais decided it would warrant other lodges, and it warranted six or so other lodges in the south of France. And various other lodges did the same thing. And the historian Torrey, who wrote the history of the Grand Orient, which we'll talk more about in a minute, said, as this developed, Freemasonry in France was then in a discordant condition. We have no register of official assemblies. Each lodge in Paris or the kingdom was the property of the individual called the master of the lodge. So each lodge was basically owned by its own master. He ran it the way he wanted to. He did what he wanted to, reported to nobody. And each body recognized no other authority than that. And he actually finishes off by saying, but 1743, Masonry presented in France a spectacle of the utmost revolting anarchy, which is a little strong maybe, but there we are. So things were not exactly well organized or structured. And then another character came on the screen, which we don't have time to get into tonight. We could spend an evening on this gentleman alone, the Chevalier Andrew Michael Ramsay, a Scotsman by origin. He came to France and was quite influential in the development of Freemasonry. Some Masonic historians attribute to him the development of the higher degrees in Freemasonry. The Knights Templar Royal Arch, the Scottish, so-called Scottish Rites. But above all, from our point of view, and we've said we can spend an evening on it, maybe next year. What we're interested in particularly was his opinion on Masonry and its relationship to the Templars and religion, which he, I don't know if he was arrogant or just his views, but anyway, he wrote this this history of religions, including Freemasonry and with it, and gave it to the cardinal. And basically what this led to was the first papal bull banning Freemasonry for Catholics, okay? Which was repeated on numerous occasions, therefore, afterwards. But this was, he's usually attributed with having started that out through this this writing. So, moving on. So there was an attempt, according to Torrey, to get a Grand Lodge in France. A number of masters of lodges met in 1743, elected the Count of Clermont Grand Master, and adopted the title at the time of the English Grand Lodge of France, which is a little strange. Which in 1756 they changed to the National Grand Lodge of France. However, this never really got off the ground, particularly because of this issue about masters of lodges being the owners of their own lodges. And it really never got into, never got underway. And in the end, the government actually banned any further assemblies of this outfit in 1767. And by 1771, the Grand Lodge was split into two groups struggling. So you can't really explain, you know, there was a lot going on. Again, within the time available, it was difficult to go into all the details, Story says. So what in fact happened was, jumping ahead, that a few years later, as the old Grand Lodge really didn't exist anymore, a new version of Grand Lodge called the Grand Orient was created. And this became really the structure and beginning of free and accepted Masonry as we would know it in France. In 1773, it held its first meeting in March and then got its constitutions adopted in June the same year, which must be a record for Freemasonry, I would think. 3 months to adopt something. But, they then started to get control of the various lodges and the higher degrees, as we know them, in the various rites going on in France. Now, a few lodges didn't like the rules. They particularly didn't like the rules that the master must be elected. So some of the old lodges actually continued under the old name of the Grande Loge de France until 1799, some 20 odd years later, when the two groups finally met together. And then really from France and England, Masonry spread. It was spreading across continental Europe. We know that it carried on into Germany, of course, Germany's six states. Sweden particularly was involved with an interchange with French Freemasonry, and that is another subject which is quite interesting. But again, time does not permit it tonight. However, the way in which the lodges worked, which we talked about earlier, the rites, the ritual, depended a lot upon who founded the lodge and who was in it. So there was a mixture of English-speaking lodges split between the old Scottish rites and the new English rite, which had been developed under the Premier Grand Lodge direction and basically becoming what was called the modern English ritual. And a lot of the French lodges followed the modern ritual in French and continued to use it after the English had stopped using it in 1813. There was what was known as a Lodge of Reconciliation after another split within the English side. And the new ritual in England was adopted in English, but in France they carried on using the old ritual, which has now become known as the French Rite, and more of that later. So by about 1788, there were some 1,250 Masonic lodges in France. A lot of different types, of different variations. And Masonry was developing very well, particularly one particular form, which we'll touch on in a minute. But then, unfortunately, the French Revolution broke out, and that developed initially as a peaceful resolution, turning in then to a definitely non-peaceful resolution. It was particularly against the three estates, the poor, this famous cartoon of the poor bowed down with the aristocracy supporting the king and the church, of course. Basically, obviously, it went then wound up with the guillotine and sort of mass murder. So this rather put Freemasonry back. It didn't stop functioning, but lost many of its noble members, of course, to the guillotine. But some gained some others of repute, at least in the short term. So among our members, of course, are Voltaire, and the Marquis de Lafayette, of course, who had a very strong influence in American history. The Marquis de Condorcet, Mirabeau, Georges Danton, the Duke d'Orléans, and Herbert. And Louis-Philippe, actually, who was one of the early leaders of the French Revolution in the liberal aristocracy, but unfortunately, and he was Grand Master of the Grand Orient, unfortunately went to the guillotine as the revolution progressed, so he was lost. So basically, and then in some parts of France, the old Jacobin clubs took over Masonic lodges and orders and rebadged themselves under the new regime as well. So this continued on for some years. And then out of this, of course, came Napoleon. And for some 12 years, France was engaged in Napoleonic Wars, a series of major conflicts. Now, one legend suggested that Napoleon had been a Mason, although it seems unlikely, because what he said about Masons Freemason is a pile of imbeciles who assemble for good cheer and for execution of many ridiculous follies. Nevertheless, they carried out good actions from time to time. So it doesn't sound like Masonic speak exactly, does it? But nevertheless, we do get events showing up on Masonry. One of the interesting ones was the Battle of Waterloo, which of course finished his rule June 16 to 18, 1815. A Belgian lieutenant of the Dutch Belgian battalion reported that I gave protection to two French officers. They gave me a Masonic sign, the sign of distress, in fact, so I took them to safety in the rear rather than leave them to be pillaged by the soldiery. So, and in fact, one of the other bits of research I have been doing, you will find lots of cases of Masonic signage appearing on fields of battle, interestingly enough. So Freemasonry was around, it was working, and Napoleon recognized its importance because after he had become legitimized the first French Empire in 1804, he appointed his brother, Joseph de Bonaparte, as Grand Master of the Grand Orient of France. So he took control. And during the First Empire, the Grand Orient was under strict control from the political authorities, and gradually, as a result, pulled in all the various lodges under its control and consolidated its control. And that was fine until Napoleon fell and we got the Bourbon Restoration in 1814. And a character which again we could spend an evening on, the Count of Grastilly, started a conflict which had been going on for some years, or restarted it, I guess, with the Bourbon Restoration. He had developed a Supreme Council of France for a particular right, the ancient and accepted Scottish right, and he was trying to get control of the lodges, and the Grand Orient was trying to get control of the lodges, so there was a conflict that went on basically until the end of the 1800s with a struggle for power between them. And with the First Empire's fall, in fact, Freemasonry also fell with it. The number of lodges in France fell to about 300 by 1820. So Freemasonry had gone into quite decline. It picked up at the end of the 1800s. Now, throughout the 19th century, it gradually became more democratic, but also more politicized. A number of Masons, in fact, were among the revolutionary, the July Revolution, and all but two of the members of the 1848 government were all Freemasons, so right in the middle of it. And lodges also became somewhat more anti-clerical as more and more Catholics left with repeated papal bulls coming out against Freemasonry. So the two things sort of combined, the attitude of the Catholic Church and the sort of general anti-clerical feeling sort of worked together. Then we came to the Second Empire. Not as successful as the first one. 1851, Napoleon III started the Second Empire, and as he was the nephew of Napoleon, and again he offered his protection to French Freemasonry as part of his thing, and he initially got appointed actually Prince Murat as its Grand Master, and then in 1862 they were allowed to elect someone, but Napoleon basically chose him, and Maréchal Magnan was elected, appointed, how you look at it, as the head of the Grand Orient. Unfortunately, he wasn't a Mason, so they had to put him through all the 33 degrees of the ancient accepted rite, so that he could become Grand Master. Emmanuel, in fact, remained Grand Master until his death in 1865. A little sideline was that at his funeral, which was a Masonic funeral, and his coffin was draped with Masonic symbols, the Archbishop of Paris actually gave him absolution for being a Mason. Okay, something which the Pope apparently wasn't very pleased about, made it clear to the Archbishop that. So, it learned its lesson to an extent from this, we basically, what happened was that the Grand Orient decided it didn't want a Grand Master anymore. So it did away with the post and the job, and it now put its leadership in the president of a council of order. Throughout this also, the Scottish, so remember we talked about a number of different rites in the Grand Orient, there was a separate Scottish rite, and that had continued through all of this period, sort of under the radar of everybody. Nobody had zeroed in on their existence, so it continued quite happily. And by 1870, the Grand Orient had about 18,000 Freemasons, and the Scottish Rite about 6,000. And so that's where we were at that point. Then Mackay, in his encyclopedia, was a little unkind, shall we say, but 1873, and he used the word continental Freemasonry. And he described this as designating the lodges on the continent of Europe, which retain many of the usages which have either been abandoned or actually never been observed in lodges in England, Ireland, Scotland, as well as the United States of America. So, basically, they're not doing what we do. But despite this, in fact, the French and English continue in amity and mutual recognition until the 1860s, 70s. And then, basically, this is really what caused the final breakup. In 1868, the Supreme Council of Ancient Ascetic Scottish Rite of the State of Louisiana, of all places, appeared in the Grand Lodge of Louisiana. Now, remember that Louisiana, of course, had been a French colony up until 1803. So, a lot of French influence there. And this Supreme Council was recognized by the Grand Orient de France, but regarded, obviously, by the Grand Lodge of Louisiana as an invasion of their jurisdiction. They weren't very happy about it. And then this body started to admit people of color, which had not been done anywhere else in Masonry up to that point. And the Grand Orient the following year passed a resolution saying that neither color, race, nor religion could disqualify a man from Masonry. And as a result of that, the Grand Lodge of Louisiana, and it persuaded a number of other Grand Lodges to withdraw recognition. We go back to this regularity issue. They no longer regarded them as regular and withdrew it. Now, finally, this dispute developed on further. And in 1875, there was Lausanne Congress Supreme Council. Lausanne Congress of Supreme Councils. And basically, at this Congress, which was a number of Grand Lodges met together, the Grand Orient decided to commission a report, which was done by a Protestant pastor, which concluded that basically Freemasonry was not a religion, therefore didn't require religious belief, which was sort of in direct conflict with the Grand Lodge of England. And they changed their constitution to say that its principle of absolute liberty of conscience and human solidarity, the existence of God and immortality of the soul being struck out. And this also needs to be seen to an extent in this anti-clerical movement, both in the Enlightenment and also in France, particularly against the Catholic Church. So there, basically where we got to was that, that now the Grand Orient is saying you don't need to believe in God to be a Freemason, which had always been the underlying principle. It didn't say who's God, but a God. And so, and at the same time, things between England and Britain, in common with the last previous 1,000 years almost, were difficult. And so the Grand Lodge of England withdrew recognition of the Grand Orient of France, a situation that continues till today. The Grand Orient of France is regarded by the United Grand Lodge of England as irregular, as we say, and as a result, basically, the situation continues with much of Freemasonry. Not all French lodges actually agreed, and a number of French lodges, in fact, at that point, 1894, created the Grand Lodge de France, and continuing the UGLE's requirement in the belief in a basic religion. So the Grand Lodge of France came in, and at the same time, as before, the Scottish Rite continued on undisturbed by all of this. They untouched. So basically, at this point, it was only the Grand Lodge of France, in fact, to an extent. There was no recognised Freemasonry in France from an English point of view, from about 1870-odd. Meanwhile, the ladies had not been idle. And in the start of the 18th century, a number of, obviously, Masonic wives and families were involved in Masonry, and a number of the ladies obviously not being permitted into Masonry under the original founding text in 1723, and some of them became quite militant, particularly Flora Tristan and Louis Michel, and a lady called Maria de Razim, who in fact managed to get herself initiated into an all-male lodge in 1882. She didn't stay there for too long, but she was initiated. As a result, she decided, in fact, with another guy, in 1882, with Georges Martin, to, in fact, create the Order Masonic Mix International de Droit Humain in 1893. So this is the order, a mixed order, international of the rights of man, essentially. So this, and again, is somewhat in conflict to normal Masonry, has quite a political bent to it, as well as the Masonic side. So this is a global fraternity. It became international. It works the Scottish Rite, the ancient accepted Scottish Rite, from the first to 33rd degree. It has a Supreme Council, and it's mixed, men and women. And they all hold all the posts. Now, in the Second World War, with the German invasion of France, in Germany, Masonry had already been suppressed quite severely under the Hitler regime, the Nazi regime, and when the Germans arrived in France at the surrender, creation of the Vichy government, as it was known, the Vichy government banned Freemasonry. And even though actually a good number, 85 of the 500-odd parliamentarians were Freemasons and 20 of the 80 deputies. And all civil servants, including teachers and the like, had to sign a document that were not Masons. As a result, some 1,500 lost their jobs, some 6,000 were arrested, about just under 1,000 were deported. They were Masons, but not so much for being Masons because of their resistance activity. And some nearly 550 died as a result. So Masonry was essentially squashed to a large extent, although it did exist in some of the prisoner of war camps, we know, and but officially it was suppressed. And it was re-established really under de Gaulle's, as de Gaulle came back at the end of the war. So moving on to the present day, the GLNF, the Grande Loge National de France, is the recognized French Masonic Grand Lodge and was founded in 1913. Two lodges were involved, the Centre des Amis, who broke away from the Grande Loge de France, Grand Orient, sorry, de France, and Les Anglais in Bordeaux, who had really always been an independent lodge anyway. And so GLNF accepted the UGLE principles of monotheism and started up those two lodges. My lodge, St. George's Lodge, is number 3, was consecrated, in fact, in April 1914, 6 months, a little under that, ahead of the First World War. And throughout the First World War, in fact, obviously, we didn't have a lot of Masonic activity in France. Most of them were at the front. Certainly, St. George's became supported two English lodges, the Pioneer Corps, for today the Logistics Regiment, and the London Irish Rifles, who actually we still have a connection with today, and we go to their installation. They're coming to ours in September. So, and it was really, I guess, into the 1920s before the GLNF started to pick up speed, started to build lodges and participation. And then in 1935, Camille Savoy created the Scottish Grand Lodge Rectified. Now, again, separate subject. Some of us attended a best part of a day on the subject back on July 14th. The significant cause was Bastille Day as well. But the Scottish Rite Rectified, Rite Écossais Rectifié, has nothing to do with Scotland. Okay, that's the first thing to understand about French rites. They're called Scottish, they're French. And it was based from a very, I guess, best description probably is quite spiritual development of Freemasonry in the 1700s, which actually had gained quite a lot of traction up until the French Revolution. And the French Revolution sort of stopped it stone dead. So it didn't develop anymore and it sort of stopped for quite a long period. And then was rediscovered almost by Camille Savoy, and they restarted this order. And what is interesting about it is basically the Grand Priory de Rules was actually again suppressed during the Second World War, and restarted in 1946 as well. It has some 1,000 members in about 50 lodges. So it's quite big. And it concentrates basically a lot on research. And yeah, I guess spiritual development is the best description of it I can think of. Female Freemasonry also moved along. So ladies created lodges from about 1935. There were 8 lodges came together to form the first, what was known as convent, and they again were suppressed during the war and came back together in 45, and in 46 got underway, and in 52 the Union Masonique Féminine de France officially became the the French, the Women's Grande Lodge of France. In 1959, it adopted the ancient accepted Scottish rite as its working rite, and then from 60 onwards, it developed further. 21 lodges were formed in France, one in Switzerland at Geneva, which is French-speaking, and during the following period, some 76 lodges were created in France, Switzerland, and Belgium, and other rites were accepted. And today, Grande Loge Féminine de France, under its leader, Marie-Thérèse Besson, the Grand Maîtress, is thriving and claims a membership of about 12,000. So quite active. So the next little hiccup was the Grande Loge traditional symbolique opera split away from the GLNF in 58. This was driven by two things. Probably the key one was too many Brits. So they didn't like 25% of the membership in the GLNF had become English, and they didn't like that. And also they wanted, remember this goes back to this regularity issue, they wanted to have relations with other groups who were not recognized by the UGLE, therefore the GLNF, like the Grand Orient. And so they went off and set up on their own. They have about 4,500 members and nearly 300 lodges in France and the rest of the world, particularly in the French, the old French colonies, but also in Italy, Brazil, Spain, and Thailand. So quite well spread. Now, the majority of Freemasonry, this is the whole issue. We have this issue about liberal continental strand to be irregular, and therefore not recognized by, really, I guess, what's coming to be Anglo-Saxon Freemasonry, although one shouldn't look at it that way, possibly. And so in 1961, they created this catchy center, the catchy name, Centre de Liaison et d'Information de Puissance Masonique, Signataire de l'Appel de Strasbourg. CLIPSAS, yes. And this is where these groups meet, and there are some 70 Grand Lodges and Grand Orients that meet under this heading. And obviously, the United Grand Lodge of England, GLF, and the Grand Lodges of America don't recognize this group, so they are basically... this distinction, as I said, between sort of Anglo-American and continental Freemasonry, really, is driven by this. And then the next breakaway was in 1968, the Loge National Francaise split away. It set up its own, it's the Federation of French Masonic Lodges. It's the main characters of this is its interesting point of view, that it recommends that each brother follow the three rites, the traditional French rite, which we'll mention in a minute, the Scottish rite rectified, the RER, and the emulation rite, which is the old English rite. So they have, they follow all three rites within this group. At 2012, it's the last numbers I've got, they have some 300 members in 17 lodges, plus 8 study research lodges. They do a lot of research. So another little fracture. And so the GLNF continued to function and was doing quite well until 2009, when we had a little bit of a crisis. In December 2009, the Grand Master of the time, Francois Stephanie, had a rebellion of his members over the use of Masonic funds, particularly, among other things, but particularly political subscriptions. Subsequently, it showed that he had pledged the allegiance of the GLNF to Nicolas Sarkozy, who was running for president, and also promised a lot of money. So there was a breakaway on this, and finally it wound up in court. And the courts basically appointed a lady actually, Mademoiselle Monique Legrand, were to take over the Grand Lodge management, and particularly obviously his money, and to keep the hands on it. And so what happened then was that the United Grand Lodge of England in 2011, followed by a number of the American Grand Lodges, suspended recognition of the GLNF. At this point, as English Masons, we could not take part, if we wanted to stay English Masons, anything the GLNF was doing. Our lodges, St. George's and a number of other lodges, went into darkness. We closed down and we stayed closed for some period. In 2012, then basically we had, so France was basically off limits to English and effectively American license. And then in 2012, in Bâle, the Grand Lodges of Switzerland, Belgium, Austria, Germany, and Luxembourg also withdrew recognition, declaring the damage irredeemable. So this basically continued so for some time. Shortly afterwards, sometime afterwards, in fact, Stephanie finally resigned, and Jean-Pierre Servelle, who is the current Grand Master, took over as Grand Master, and Mademoiselle Legrand handed back control of the GLNF to Servelle. Servelle suspended, then finally expelled Stephanie. However, this didn't really solve the problem immediately, because obviously Grand Master Servelle had quite a lot of clearing up to do. And so through 2013, there was still no recognition. And it wasn't until June 2014 that we got the lodges basically re-recognized. The Grand UGLE, followed by the American lodges and the other Grand Lodges, re-recognized the GLNF. And St. George's, among other lodges, could come back into the light. In fact, unfortunately, one of the things that happened was that a number of the lodges did not reawaken, which was a loss from our point of view, but a number did. So that's where we were in 2014. So looking at the French situation today, there are a number of rights and obediences. There are some 1,276 active lodges, of which 14 are English-speaking. We had a special meeting last year, for the 300th anniversary of the English-speaking lodges in Paris, with about 29,000 brethren, essentially, in the GLNF. As is common in European Masonry, administration is just one Grand Lodge, GLNF, and then provinces. So we have the four provinces around Paris, and then each geographic area has its own provinces. Not surprisingly, there's a concentration of lodges in Paris, right, I guess like New York, and the Grand Lodge building at Rue Christian-Pizan has some 20 temples, three chapter temples, a large grand temple, and most importantly, a full restaurant service, okay, for post-meetings. The other thing which is sort of slightly odd in the culture for an Englishman is certainly different. So each lodge operation obviously is slightly different. So the officers working the different rites, you would, as Americans, recognize a lot of the French and Scottish bits of the rites, but the English emulation actually would look very strange to you, particularly the layout of the lodge and the way it is done. So the staff at Pizan actually have to go around and rearrange the lodge rooms depending upon who's working in them and doing what. Most lodges meet monthly, once a month, 8 to 10 meetings a year. All lodges have festive boards, which personally I think is an important part of the Masonic experience, with the usual formal and informal toasts. French lodges avert various rites, French in culture, handshakes and kissing on arrival. Three kisses. There's a very definite French protocol about kissing. Two, three, four, or one. It's a bit disconcerting as an English Mason to have some large Frenchman descended upon you puckered up. But, you know, when in Rome. Also, French lodges read their ritual. They don't memorize it. English-speaking lodges tend to memorize their ritual, as most of your lodges do, English lodges do. The French lodges read it. One of the more interesting French ritual habits is the blindfold interview. The potential candidate is brought into the lodge blindfolded. He's interviewed by the members of the lodge and taken out again, and then brought to the festive board unblindfolded to join the lodge. And then people can decide, he can decide where he wants to come, and they can decide whether or not they want him to join. So foreign lodges like ourselves, English-speaking lodges, are typically about half French-speaking, half French nationals, or mix of other people as well. We've got Filipinos, we've got people from Eastern Europe, etc. I can see wrap-up time. So just to finish off, range of rites in the GLNF. Ancient and accepted Scottish rite, the most widely, 413 lodges, and that is, of course, not Scottish, but French. That includes the Knight Templar, Knights of Malta, etc. The emulation rite, 270 lodges, which is the rite that was developed out of the Lodge of Reconciliation, the creation of the United Grand Lodge of England. The French rite, 252 lodges. This has grown considerably since it started about 20 years ago. The brethren were investigating the RER, came across this. This was based, if you remember, upon the English modern rite, which was dropped out in 1813. And it was brought back, of all places, from Brazil, where it was still practiced and regarded as regular. So, and apparently there are a lot of French rite lodges in Brazil. The story of that is for another day as well. Then we have, we mentioned the Scottish rectified rite, 194 lodges. And we have York rite, similar to your rite, with French-speaking lodges working this rite in French, and some English-speaking lodges, one of whom in Pisan claims to be Californian. I can't comment. And then finally, we have the Scottish rite, which is the Grand Lodge of Scotland's rite, pure, as you would find in Scotland, 71 lodges. And then we have two lodges of research, my lodge, which is English-speaking, the Phoenix Lodge, which is the research lodge of the province of Lutèce, and Villard de Honnecourt, which is the GLNF's lodge. So we've got plenty of choice for you if you visit. We have visitors in St. George's the last year or so, Ukraine, Lithuania, Poland, Romania, Canada, Belgium, etc. And obviously, all of you would be welcome to come by. The GLNF, in fact, is the second largest body. The Grand Orient is still larger, okay? And obviously has a much longer history. The GLNF has recovered really from 2009, is stable and is continuing to develop, I think, quite well, and is very active. So, thank you.